last three models, we have discussed about in situ sensors and platforms for ocean observing system. In the next model, we will be discussing about what are the remote sensing system for ocean observing. So these are the various parameters you can observe from the ocean from the satellites. So altimetry, gravimetry, sea surface temperature, ocean color, sea surface roughness, sea ice, winds. These are the various parameters you can monitor from the satellites. The advantage in satellite is you can cover wide range, synoptically you can cover, but the disadvantage is only you can go only at the surface, you can monitor, you cannot go in the subsurface. So that is a disadvantage. So now we will discuss about how it is measured from the remote sensing satellites. So the remote sensing satellites are two kinds it has been used. One is passive sensors, another one is active sensors. In passive sensors, the solar radiation and emitted radiations are used to observe the ocean, and the active sensors, you send the pulse from the satellite, and from that reflected or the information from the energy reflected from the ocean, you infer how the ocean structure is. In the passive solar radiations, basically they use visible and near infrared wavelength, and they measure the light reflected at the surface, and they can use the multiple spectral band, and it scans various images, and it measures the water properties, for example color. And typical satellites are CVPS and MODIS and OceanSat 2. The sensors is OCM, that is ocean color monitor, and MODIS sensors. The important problem with this, it is obstructed by clouds. Whenever there is a cloud, you will not able to monitor the ocean color or whatever the information, and also it is obstructed by the atmospheric disturbances. So for cater the atmospheric disturbance, we should have some other wavelength we should monitor the things. In the passive emitted radiations, we have used two band. One is thermal infrared and another one is a microwave. In thermal infrared, they use multiple wave bands, and the problem again here, it is obstructed by clouds and require atmospheric corrections, but this will provide very high resolution image of the particular ocean. And for example, sea surface temperature up to 1 kilometer resolution, you will be getting the polar orbiting satellites of NOAA AVHRR. It provides the sea surface temperature 1 kilometer resolutions, but nowadays people started measuring from the geostationary satellite also. But if you use microwave, here also multiple frequency bands they use. The advantage is it can see through the clouds, and it is independent of the atmosphere. Whatever the atmosphere contains, it will not bother, it will see through that. But however, it gives only very low resolutions. Since the microwave energy, you require large area, so the resolution of the data is about 25 kilometer. So it can measure sea surface temperature, sea surface roughness, sea surface salinity, and whereas all the microwave sensors are used for these ocean parameters. Some of the active sensors also used for the ocean observations. So the one is scatterometer. Basically here radar pulse, it has been sent to the ocean obliquely, so that the return pulse has been measured, the energy is measured. From that indirectly, the scatter information from the surface, it has been obtained. From that we can get the wind speed. So the wind speed indirectly monitored from the sea surface roughness, from that we get the information. And also we are sending the obliquely the radar pulse, and afterwards in other time it goes to other direction also, we send the radar pulse. From that we can get the direction information of the wind. It can provide the wind speed and direction information from the scatterometer. The other active sensor is the altimeter. Here it is essentially measure the timing and shape and strength of the return pulse, and from that we get the information about the sea level and the wave, and also from indirectly sea surface roughness, that is a wind speed also we get it. So these are the different active sensors used for the ocean observation system. So now I'll be briefly mentioning about how that principles of altimetry works. So from the satellite at a height of about 400 kilometer in the polar orbiting satellites, you send the microwave pulse to the ocean surface, and once it reflected back, after touching the ocean, it reflected back, and the reflected signal you obtain. So the time delay between these two, it will provide the sea level informations. Basically, the sea surface height is a function of the orbit, satellite orbit, and also the time delay and the geoid information. So the geoid and orbit is known. The A is measured by the time delay. From that, we will be able to get the sea level information in the ocean. The parameters from altimeter. Once we get the altimeter data, we can get the sea level, sea surface height, and significant wave height, and also wind speed, and ice, land, lakes, all, and also river monitoring. Everything we can get from the altimeter. But some of the limitations also there with the altimeter. That is, it measures only along the precise orbit and repeat track with accuracy of 2 to 3 centimeter. Detects only the variable signal, and sea surface height is unreliable in self seas, and currents cannot be resolved or recovered in the equatorial waters because of the Coriolis less Coriolis force. The applications of altimeters are plenty. It is used for various disciplines like geodesy and geophysics, ocean, ice, climate, atmosphere, and hydrology, and other coastal applications. For the ocean, it is very important is the sea level, and indirectly we can get the mesoscale circulation pattern, and also we can get the geostrophic currents in the ocean at any point of time. The repeatability of altimeter is about 10 days. So at every 10 days, we will get the sea level. So from 1993 onwards, we have continuously monitoring the sea level. So now we can, from that entire globe, once in 10 days, you have the sea level. From that, how the sea level rise is happening and other things we can monitor. The next one is a scatterometer. The scatterometer is a typical one is a quick scat, and it send the pulse to ocean about 13.4 gigahertz. And it is wind speeds are measured by measuring the scatter. And the wind speed able to, the measurement range is from 3 to 20 meter per second with an accuracy of 2 meter per second, and the direction accuracy about 20 degree, and the spatial resolution is about 25 kilometer spatial resolution. The main advantage is once in 2 days, you get entire global coverage of wind speed, what is happening, wind speed and directions. The incident angle is constant across the swath. So there is no difference in one place to another place. So the consistency is maintained. The main disadvantage is wind retrievals is more sensitive to the rain. Whenever there is a rain is occurring, you will have a wind retrieval algorithm is having some problem. Similarly, retrieval performance varies across the measurement swath. At the edge of the swath, only 2 instead of 4 looks are possible. So these are some of the disadvantages. But having scatterometer, we will get the wind speed and direction, entire global ocean, you will get the information at entire global ocean. The typical application of altimeter and scatterometer, as I mentioned in the first module, the geostrophic currents you can get from the altimeter, and the Ekman currents you can get from the scatterometer. So combine this geostrophic currents and Ekman currents, you vectorially you add it, you can get the total currents in the entire oceans. So this is a typical application. Once you know the currents, then you can have other platforms to other variables. The ocean color. The ocean color, basically, when it is the source is used as a sun as a source, whenever the sunlight sent to the it is absorbed in the ocean, some of the light is absorbed by the ocean, some is scattered back, and some is reflected back, and some is scattered by the atmospheric module itself. So by knowing different wavelength, by using different wavelength, we can distinguish each one what is doing, then we can get the surface, sea surface roughness and the color of the ocean. From that we can indirectly monitor the chlorophyll and sediment sediments and other informations over the oceans. So typical application of ocean color is a measurement of chlorophyll. So you can get the global distribution of chlorophyll, estimate of primary productivity, and also phytoplankton blooms we can monitor. And also you can see optical diffuse attenuation coefficient, measurement of suspended sediments, dissolved oxygens, monitoring some pollutions, and it is very useful for a climate monitoring for the long-term purpose. So all the disciplinary, physical oceanography, fisheries oceanography, coastal management, biogeochemistry, all the people, they use the ocean color for a variety of applications. The next sensor in the satellite is the radiometers. So this is, again, it is infrared radiometers and microwave sensors are used. In the resolution, as I pointed out earlier, the resolution is very high, about 1 kilometer resolution, global coverage, and accuracy is about 0.4 to 0.5 Kelvin. And problem in measuring SST is below the cloud. That is only disadvantage in the infrared radiometers. And nowadays, it is also used in geostationary satellite apart from polar orbiting satellites. So you could get a 3 to 5 kilometer resolution instead of 1 kilometer in polar orbit. And it is having high temporal sampling. And that is the biggest advantage. And the microwave sensor, there are 11 gigahertz. It is used for SST. And the typical is a TMI in TRIM and AMSRE. These are the various sensors. And the resolution is only 25 kilometer. The accuracy is about 0.6 and 7. And the highest advantage is it can penetrate through cloud. This is very good for the, especially the monsoon region like India, where we can use these sensors even though the resolution is very coarse. There are other satellites are available for the ocean probe. It is called SAR, Synthetic Aperture Radar, GRACE, that is a GRACE gravity, for ESMAS and Aquarius, for salinity. You can monitor from ESMAS and Aquarius satellites, you can monitor the sea surface salinity. And there are some, for coastal applications, resource that can be used for changing the coastal and other belts. So these are the various satellite system it is available for monitoring the ocean. In other remote sensing application is the radar. This is a HF radar. So this HF radar, basically it is used to monitor the currents and the waves from the coast to up to 100 to 200 kilometer distance. You can continuously, real time, you can monitor the currents and waves. When you operate some particular frequency, you will be able to get the current information. When you switch over to other frequency, you will be able to get the wave information. Basically, the radar pulse, once this is a transceiver, you can send the radar pulse to the ocean. It is about 100 kilometer distance, and the return pulse also you monitor from the each wave crest, and by Doppler shift, how much Doppler shift it is occurring, from that Doppler principle, you will be able to get the ocean current informations. So the difference between the measured speed and the known speed of the waves are the ocean surface currents. That is the main principle in working in the HF radar. In India, these are the different pair of HF radar in the east coast, and we have Andaman one pair, and then west coast is one pair. So each place it is required two pairs, so that this particular two pair can cover this much area of waves and winds information we can get the real time. This is a typical transceiver antenna, and this is the area where how much you can cover in one pair of HF radar antennas. So presently we have 5 sets of radar, and also it enables waves and currents up to 100 kilometers. So this 100 kilometers or 200 kilometers, it depends on the weather. Suppose we have a rough sea, you can go up to 150 to 200 kilometers, but the sea is very calm, then it will be the probing or the observation length will be, area will be reduced accordingly. So these are the different temporal and spatial scale is what is called in the ocean behaves. So we have to understand where we have to observe or where we have to, what is the requirement, depending upon our requirement, we have to select the platform. Suppose I want to have a measurement of a diurnal scale, then we have to use the mooring observations, that means hourly to diurnal. For long-term climate, we can use all the informations, we can use it. The floats information will provide this type of time scale. That means you have a time scales of decade and a few days to decade. And also the horizontal spatial resolution, it can give 100 meter to 10,000 kilometers. So this is a voluntary observations, and this is a float informations, and this is a satellite information, and this is a glider information will provide in the both the horizontal space as well as the time scales. It is one who has to, who wants and what scale they have to select, and according to select the ocean observation platforms. Some of the high frequency, these are the individual movement you want to monitor, you have to go for very high frequency, whereas the new technology such as I was telling the Lagrangian floats and also other Kuiper and other things can be used to monitor the turbulence. So these are the various temporal scale and spatial scale exist in the oceans. So in order to choose the right platform is very important. So one who has to use the platform depending upon their applications. So these are the some of the useful books for remote sensing observations. So some of the things, very especially satellite Robinson book is very useful for in-situ observations. I have written also some two chapters in in-situ observations. It can be in the Springer volume, you can look at it. And all the platforms, whatever I discussed, it has been discussed in these books. Thank you very much.